Hi, I'm Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years. On this channel, I'd like to give you tips and tricks for being successful in academia. And in this video, I wanted to give you my suggestions for an ultimate PhD application timeline. It can be very tricky for students to know when they should be doing certain things. So I wanted to give you what I would consider a ultimate comprehensive guideline year by year with milestones for each year to make you be successful in your application process. Let's jump in. Okay, so I've broken this down into 4 years and there's 3 milestones per year. And you might be thinking, that's a lot of years. And it truly is. And part of the reason that I'm suggesting a 4-year application timeline is oftentimes students tend to rush things in the final years and they would have been a very strong applicant, but there's some groundwork that they missed. So for year 1, I'm considering this an exploration year. This is, you're just thinking about potentially pursuing a PhD, and there's some things that you need to do to explore early on to ensure that you're going into the right programs and that all of these later efforts are actually used very strategically. So when I say exploration, I'm talking about trying to find the things and interests that really inspire you. What are you so excited to work on for your entire life moving forward? And that can be very hard if you have no background in research at all. So one of the things that you want to do is consider applying to work in different research labs. Now there's lots of complicated ways that this can be very challenging, in part because you don't have any background yet, so you're not bringing a lot of skills to the table. But what I recommend you do is you take courses from particular professors for which you're interested in applying to work with them. And you do very well in the course, utilize things like office hours to get to know them more personally, and then apply to work with them in their lab. They will know you to some degree as a student, and so it'll be a little bit easier of an inroad into doing research with them. So you want to do this and explore. Do one lab for one semester, another lab for another semester. Apply for a few labs and potentially work at multiple labs at the same time. The goal primarily is for you to explore, to find your interests, and really to cast a wide net to ensure that what you're focusing on in future years is really going to be useful and suited to your interests. What you don't want to do is maybe dedicate a lot of time to a particular research area and then figure out you don't like it at all and have to switch, because some of those things don't necessarily transfer that you learned. So you want to be strategic here. In this first exploration year, you also want to use courses as a way to explore different topics. So this is a really, really good time for you to try out diverse range of courses to see if you like the nature of the work. The way that the course is organized will give you some clues about the types of things that that type of discipline does and focuses on, and you will learn that you like some and you don't like others. So taking courses is a great opportunity just to get a flavor of the type of research that is done. And when you do take these courses, you want to perform well in the classes, because ultimately you might be applying to work with one of the professors that have taught those courses, or in your PhD application, they will focus on the grades that you've gotten in those particular courses. So it's very important that you do well in these courses to illustrate that you'd be successful in a PhD program. My third milestone for year 1 is to make connections with professors. This is hard and scary, and I want you to practice it as early as possible. The easiest way to do this is to go to office hours, and I'll have a whole video on kind of optimizing office hours. But of course, go to office hours if you need help or support in a class, but you can also go to office hours to engage a professor in their research. So there's nothing stopping you from reading one of their research papers and going to office hours to discuss that with them. That is a great opportunity to see if you like the way that they do research, how they talk about the research, the way they would interact with you. That might give you a clue to see if you want to end up working with them. This is part of laying the foundation for ensuring that you can get in a good lab and you can get good letters of recommendation. You need professors on your side to support you in this application process. So in year 1, starting building those connections is really important and a great skill that will serve you throughout all of your education. That brings us to year 2. Year 2 is all about gathering the essential items that you will put in your application. I'll start with the one that related to my last point, which is getting good, strong, glowing letters of recommendation. I actually have another video on securing letters of recommendation that I will link below. But the idea is that this phase, year two. Ideally, you have been working with a professor for a little bit of time, ideally volunteering in a lab, and you want to strengthen those relationships so they will write you the most exciting, glowing letter of recommendation possible. To be clear, you need three. So it's not enough to focus in on just one group and one individual. You need three letters of recommendation. The best letters of recommendation come from professors that you've worked with outside of the classroom. You can get professors that you have taken classes from to write you letters, but it will be very brief, a few paragraphs probably. The people that you have worked more with, that have more personal expertise and know about your skills, those are the individuals that you want letters of recommendation from. So you need to build those relationships, not just with one person, but you need three. So in year two, you really want to focus on who are those people that might give you an excellent letter of recommendation? What do you need to really show that you are an excellent student going above and beyond so they can say things like, "This is the best student I've had in the last 20 years." Those types of statements and letters of recommendation really get noticed. So you want to be that person, and establishing these relationships is a perfect time in year two to do that. The second milestone in year two that I think you need to do is to now begin to hone in your research interests. Year one was about exploring. Year two, you want to start to identify the main things that you want to study for your PhD. And the reason this is important is because now moving forward, you want to strategically pick opportunities that will make you a stronger applicant. So you need to start figuring out, what do I actually really like? What connects with me? And once you've identified those things, you want to apply to work specifically in labs that do the research that is most related to that particular interest. You want to take courses that will supplement those skills. And what I would encourage you to do is to look at the graduate students in programs that you want to apply to and see the skills that they are using and try to take courses early on to build up those skills. And in particular, if you want to be a top applicant, find the hardest skill to do and start working on that early. So you can go into your interview process and say, "I know generative AI," or "I know this complicated mathematical process," or whatever it is in your field that is actually cutting edge. Give yourself some time to learn it, because it will be hard. And showing that you have that skill coming in will put you above everyone else. The last milestone for year two is building your CV. You will have a few items on your CV at this point. Hopefully you'll have some lab experience at a few labs potentially. The next thing you want to do is to have lines that are more high profile. And those are publications, funding, and presentations. At year two, you are probably not going to be publishing papers yet. Maybe you will, that's great. You should aim for that if you can. But you will probably be in a position to present some of the research that you've been working on. And at, I think, every university, there are opportunities for students to present their work, often in a poster form. So I'd encourage you at this point, if you have any lab experience, offer to present that research in an undergraduate research symposium or in some capacity where you can kind of present the ideas. They don't necessarily have to be yours. You don't have to be the first author, but you can present the work, and many professors are very comfortable with that, even if you didn't drive the work. It gives you practice presenting, it advertises the research, and it's another line on your CV. Any type of presentation that you can apply for at your university, do it. Also, apply for every single award possible. And it might be nerve-wracking, because at this point you'll need a letter of recommendation for these awards, and that will get whoever you're working with in the practice of writing these small letters of recommendation that will ultimately help build up for the future big letter of recommendation. But apply for everything. You're trying to pad your CV with presentations, awards, and, you know, ultimately the holy grail is a paper, of course. But at year two, I think you can definitely do an undergraduate research presentation. All right, we're moving on to year three. Year three is all about preparing your application materials so they can be as strong as possible. Hopefully you've done several years of research at this point, you have some presentations. Now you need to kind of pull all of this together and really make a strong application. So the first thing you're going to want to do in year three is to reach out and start to see who is accepting PhD students. I have a whole video on contacting professors, and you should do this as early as humanly possible. There is this psychological effect that the more people are familiar with you, the more they like you. So the more you're on their radar, the better. I think at a minimum, you need to email different professors you're thinking of applying to work with. But I think a better approach is to try to find opportunities to meet them in person, to connect with them on some capacity. I know that can be scary, but if you get some FaceTime with these individuals, it will definitely increase your chance of getting into those labs. So that's gonna make a stronger application if you work a great deal in year three of making these connections with advisors. And I wanna be clear that kind of moving forward, we're gonna be in a situation due to the funding goings on in academia that it's gonna be a more competitive market for you. There's gonna be fewer PhD spots moving forward. So doing some of these things, like making connections with advisors early on, potential advisors, is really going to make your application stand out. The second milestone I would encourage you to do in year three is to get those slam dunk items on your CV. Slam dunk item is a published paper or a major grant or a major award. This can be terrifying, but now in year three, you hopefully will have been doing 2 years of research, and ideally you want that to result in a published paper where you are an author, potentially the first author on that paper. That is really what you want to shoot for. So when you're thinking about these lab experiences, you want to, you know, in the first year, branch out, and the second year, specialize. And in the third year, you want to take the lead on some projects that will ultimately result in publishing a paper, okay? That should be the major goal. So hopefully you will have had some seniority in this particular lab, and what you want to do is to start taking initiative and volunteering for things. Start asking to have more responsibilities, to drive projects, potentially even pitch your own project that you can lead. Doing all of these things after you've built this groundwork, demonstrating that you're reliable and a strong student, will lead to the professor or PI saying, okay, I think you're ready to take the lead in this role. And you want that to result in a publication. So that is a slam dunk item on your CV. It's definitely what you should shoot for in year three. And of course, the third item in year three is actually preparing your application materials. This involves writing a research statement, actually getting those letters of recommendation, and sending in your transcripts to different schools. So I actually have a whole video on those different elements, but once you've made it to this point, it should be fairly easy for you to write a research or personal statement, because you'll be able to have all of these informative experiences that led you to where you are today. And importantly, you will have a very clear understanding of why you want to study what you're proposing to study. Hopefully you will have done that background information gathering, that you have a laser focused idea that this is the most important thing you can be working on. You have built all of these skills, you're very prepared, and you're just presenting your case that you should be hired for this PhD position. Now, in terms of timeline, something to think about is when you're actually preparing these. I would say prepare at the beginning of the year, writing these research statements and making sure that they align with the people that you're applying to work with. That's kind of a process, because it takes a while for them to respond to emails, etc. But the actual applications tend to be due early mid-December. And then after those applications come in, you'll start to get offers to interview. And when I'm talking about a timeline, I'm usually talking about the physical year, you know, January 1st to December 31st. So within this third year, you will actually be applying and submitting your materials kind of November to December. And you'll really want to have spent all of the summer and early part of the fall semester preparing those and sharing them with people to get feedback on. Now in year four, which is what we're jumping into, that's when you actually will probably do some of the interviews. You might actually do some interviews in year three, based on how quickly they do interviews. But by and large, interviews are conducted in January and February. So year four is all about sealing the deal. Okay, you've done all of this work, you've submitted your materials. Now the major milestone is actually doing interviews. I have several videos on doing interviews as well that I'll link in the description. But hopefully you are now at a place where you're secure and strong in your research, and all of that preparation will actually help you do very well in interviews. Like I already said, interviews should be probably December to February, but they could extend longer. After that, then you should be getting PhD offers. And I also have a video on comparing PhD offers. I know I have lots of sub videos for these categories, but you should start to get offers if they're coming in February-ish. And usually there is a deadline for accepting offers. So you can consider that deadline for accepting offers the last date you would probably get an offer. Now, I will say in terms of a timeline that you might be someone's first choice, so you get an offer early, but you might be a little bit lower on the list. No, there's no shame with that. But those offers might come in a little bit later. So don't get, you know, your hope is not lost if you're not getting offers, you know, February 1st, but just know that they can come in all the way up until the final deadline, which tends to be April 15th about, when all offers need to be accepted. So that's kind of the timeline for that offer review process. And my third milestone in year four is preparing to be a PhD student. You will have accepted an offer by April 15th, and then you have some time to actually prepare and get yourself centered. I think there's a few important ways to consider doing this. I think one is maybe take a break if you need it. I know you've probably had a lot building up to this. You've had, you know, really tense educational experience, or if you're coming from other, you know, fields, you will have had a lot of work to get to this point. It is smart to take a little bit of a break over that summer to really center yourself and make sure that you are prepared. So I definitely encourage you to feel kind of emotionally ready. If you are feeling drained, if you're feeling, you know, like you're burnt out, take a break. Take some self-care, because it's gonna get kind of intense as soon as you start your PhD process. So definitely take that time that you need to refresh yourself. The other things that you can do over the summer is I would encourage you to reach out to the place that you have accepted the offer from and ask if there's anything you should do to prepare. They might have a reading list that you should do over the summer. They might actually have a skill that they'd like you to learn over the summer. That would be really helpful. Having just a little bit extra time to develop some of these things can be useful. So you can really use that summer time to make sure that you are very well prepared to have a strong start to your PhD. I hope this was helpful. This is my comprehensive timeline for applying to PhD programs. I would say that the number one thing students get wrong is that they just start a little too late. They start maybe their junior year, and they do apply to work for a lab, but they have one semester, maybe two semesters of lab experience, and then they want to go into a PhD program. And the truth is that most of those applicants, it is unclear if they actually want to work on the thing that they're applying to work for their PhD, because they haven't tried a lot of things out. So it can be very nerve-wracking as a professor to evaluate those candidates, because it isn't clear if they're just gonna hate it 2 years in, which definitely happens. I think different types of work work for different people. So I think it's so important to do those first year foundational activities of really doing a wide spread in terms of looking at your interests and making sure what you're committing to for 5 years is something that you truly love, that you're very passionate about, that you're gonna be excited to do for that period of time. I hope that's helpful. If you made it to this point in the video, thank you so much for watching. Definitely consider subscribing if you're interested in more of these tips for success in academia, and definitely give a like if you found this video useful. Take care.